In the next few lectures, we will discuss the notion of eigenvalues, eigenvectors, etc. But the motivation comes from the following problem. Okay, so let me write down the topic first. Eigenvalues and eigenvectors for linear transformations. Okay. Let's say we have an operator T over V. A finite dimensional vector space V. Okay, then we know how to write down the matrix of the linear operator corresponding to a basis. The question is, can we obtain a basis script B such that the matrix of T relative to this basis BB, but we use the short notation, such that this is simple given a basis. Is there a basis? The question is there a basis such that the matrix of T relative to that basis is simple? Now what we need to interpret this word simple, make it precise. The simplest linear the simplest matrices apart from the scalar matrices, that is a matrix is called a scalar matrix if it is k times identity. That is the simplest. The next simplest is the class of diagonal matrices. So we will ask this question to begin with. Can we find a basis B of V such that the matrix of T relative to that basis is a diagonal matrix? Okay. So this is one of the interpretations of what a simple operator is. So let us precisely ask this question. Does there exist a basis B of V such that the matrix of T relative to that basis is a diagonal matrix? Let me use the letter capital D for that. What is this? This is diagonal of, let us say, D11, D22, etc., DNN. That is, this matrix has this form. Okay, I will choose alpha. Alpha 11, alpha 22, etc., alpha NN. All other entries are 0. All other entries are 0. The diagonal entries are these numbers alpha ii. Now, it is quite possible that some of these alpha ii's are also 0. Okay. But that does not matter. Off diagonal entries are 0. That is what I am imposing on the matrix of the linear transformation relative to a fixed basis B. What is the advantage of this? First of all, what is the meaning of this? What does it say about the transformation T? And what is the advantage of this? If a matrix T, if a linear operator T has this property, then we will say that T is diagonalizable. Okay. Let us first give this definition. We will simply say that in this case, T is said to be diagonalizable. Okay, in this case, we say that T is diagonalizable. We say that T is diagonalizable. The question is, are all operators on finite dimensional vector spaces diagonalizable? Before answering this question, let us see what it means. I mean, what is the advantage of? Suppose we know that an operator is diagonalizable, then what are the advantages? if T is diagonalizable, then we have the following. I'll use the previous notation, okay, the notation that we have developed here. If T is diagonalizable, what this means is that T U1, for instance, can you see it is alpha 11 U1, where I am using the notation U1, U2, etcetera for the basis elements. If I denote the basis B by U1, U2, etcetera, UN, N is a dimension of the space V, then T U1 is alpha 11, U1, T U2 is alpha 22, U2, etcetera. I have these equations. T UI is alpha II UI. Okay. T UI is alpha II UI. This describes, we know that the action of T on a basis describes T completely. This of course describes T completely. So let me give the definition of an eigenvalue. Let T belong to LV, a number lambda in F. F is underlying field, either R or C. Yeah. No. Please check this. This is correct. A number lambda in F is called an eigenvalue or a characteristic value. There are other names like latent value, etcetera. A number lambda in F, F is underlying field for me, V is defined over F. A number lambda in F is called an eigenvalue of T, eigenvalue of T. If there exists x not equal to 0 in V such that Tx equals lambda x. Now let me emphasize that this x must not be 0, so I will write that here. This should go along with the equation Tx equals lambda x. Does this equation have a solution? For some x non-zero, for some number lambda, this lambda comes from the underlying field. Okay. If it is a real vector space, I demand that the number must be a real number. If it is over the field of quotients, the number lambda must be a fraction. Okay. So we demand that this lambda belongs to F. Then this lambda is called an eigen value. Any vector x that satisfies this equation is called an eigenvector. I will simply say any such x satisfying the above is called an eigenvector. There is a correspondence, it is called an eigenvector corresponding to the eigenvalue. Corresponding to the eigenvalue lambda. Any such vector x that satisfies this equation is called an eigenvector or a characteristic vector or a latent vector corresponding to the eigenvalue lambda. Okay. Question, do all linear transformations have eigenvalues? Let us first look at a simple example. Maybe before we look at that example, can you see that this is really solving a homogeneous equation? It is like T minus lambda I of x is equal to 0. Then I look at the matrix of T relative to some basis. Then T minus lambda I x is equal to 0 is equivalent to A minus lambda I x is equal to 0. Okay. Let us look at first an example. Let's take the rotation transformation. Let's take the rotation transformation. Rotation transformation. Remember this equation Tx equals lambda x. The operator T acts on x, and then the resultant vector must be along the direction of x. That's what this means. The resultant vector must be along the direction of x, a multiple of x. So rotation vector, rotation matrix, rotation operator, will that have an eigenvalue geometrically? Provided, okay, let's say what is a rotation matrix? It corresponds to what? Cos theta minus sin theta cos theta. Let me say that the angle theta lies between 0 and 180 strictly. Does it have an eigenvector? So I have this in particular. Define T from R2 to R2 real space by T of x1, x2 is minus x2 comma x1. So this is what I said corresponds to 90 degrees really, right? Minus x2, x1. Does this have an eigenvalue? So for this problem, let's do it by looking at the first definition. I look at Tx equal, lambda x equals Tx equals minus x2 comma x1. But lambda x on the other hand is lambda x1, lambda x2. Okay, let us remove the case lambda is 0. If lambda is 0, can you see that x is 0? That's because of this. So I need lambda, I'm looking for an eigenvector. So this cannot be 0. So lambda cannot be 0. Lambda is 0, then x is 0. I am looking at an eigenvector. I am seeking an eigenvector. So lambda cannot be 0. Now look at these two equations. From this second one, x1 is lambda x2. x2 is minus lambda x1. So this is lambda into minus lambda x1. That is minus lambda square x1. That is 1 plus lambda square x1 is 0. Lambda is a real number. We are seeking lambda, a real number. So from this it follows that x1 is 0. Go back to this equation. x1 is lambda x2. Lambda is not 0, x1 is 0, so x2 is 0. So x is 0. So in either case there is no non-zero vector x that satisfies this equation. Tx equals lambda x is not satisfied by any non-zero vector x. So this linear operator T does not have an eigenvalue. Okay. This linear operator T does not have an eigenvalue. Now this is a problem with the underlying field. The underlying field is R. R is not algebraically closed from group theory. A field is said to be algebraically closed if any polynomial of degree n whose coefficients come from the underlying field has precisely n zeros. What is the polynomial which does not have 0 here? The polynomial t square plus 1. The polynomial p of t equal to t square plus 1 does not have a 0 over R. R is not algebraically closed. So the problem in this case, the operator T does not have an eigenvalue, has come from the deficiency of the field. The deficiency is really from the field, okay. This is one possibility. I look at the other possibilities, but before that, for the case of 2 by 2, for an operator T on R2, all this can be done. But if I have an operator on R3, then this can get quite complicated. So we need to translate this into the language of matrices. So let's translate this problem into one for matrices and then look at matrices. Let's remember that T is Okay. Okay, tell me if this is okay. T minus lambda I is not invertible if and only if A minus lambda I is not invertible. We have proved this before, where A is a matrix of T relative to a particular basis B. Do you remember that we have proved this result, that if T is a linear transformation, A is a matrix of T, and if T is invertible, then A is invertible. In fact, the matrix of T inverse is the inverse of the matrix A. Okay, the matrix of T inverse is the inverse of the matrix A. So remember that here I is the identity transformation. I am applying T minus, I am looking at the matrix of T minus lambda I relative to B. I relative to B, the matrix of identity transformation relative to B is identity matrix. Here remember that we are, I hope you remember that this is what we have. Relative to two bases, we write a linear transformation. If it's an operator, then we work with only one basis, okay. If you have two bases, then the identity transformation relative to two bases need not be the identity matrix, okay. But with respect to a single basis, this is the identity matrix. So let's remember, this is the identity transformation, this is the identity matrix. So this is not invertible if and only if this is not invertible, okay. Then the question boils down to, so I am seeking Tx equals lambda x with x not equal to 0. This is the same as T minus lambda I x equal to 0. Null space of T minus lambda I, that is null space of A minus lambda I by this identification. So I have A minus lambda I x equal to 0, x not equal to 0. Now the question is over homogeneous equations. I have a matrix, let us say B x equal to 0, I want x not equal to 0. I know that this has a solution if and only if the row reduced echelon form of this coefficient matrix has at least one 0. The last row, at least the last row is 0. There may be more zeros. There may be more 0 rows, okay. In other words, this matrix cannot be invertible. If A minus lambda I is invertible, I can pre-multiply by A minus lambda I to conclude that x is 0. So if I am seeking x to be non-zero, then A minus lambda I cannot be invertible. In terms of determinants, this means determinant of A minus lambda I is 0. So the question is, does this equation have a solution? Now what kind of an equation is this? T having lambda as an eigenvalue reduces to lambda satisfying this equation. What equation is this? Determinant, yeah, it is a polynomial equation. Determinant expansion along, let us say, the first row or the first column. This is a polynomial of degree n. It is a monic polynomial. The coefficient of lambda to the n is 1 or minus 1, does not matter, you have 0 here. So this is a polynomial equation where the polynomial is of degree n. It is what is called as a monic polynomial. The coefficient of the highest degree is 1. So we need to solve this polynomial equation, okay. That polynomial equation is called the characteristic. I will call P of T as, P of lambda as determinant of A minus lambda I. Okay, this notation is for the determinant. This is called the characteristic polynomial of A. It is called the characteristic polynomial of A. We observe that it is a polynomial of degree. This is a monic polynomial of degree n. the monic polynomial of degree n. Now this is a difficult problem in numerical linear algebra, but we are going to do problems of the size 3 by 3, so it should not be difficult. Okay, before we proceed to other examples, let us also make the following observation. I am going to use some of the properties of determinants that I am sure you are aware of. For instance, determinant of a product is a product of the determinants. Okay, determinant of AB is equal to determinant A into determinant B. I am assuming that A and B are both square. What about matrices that are similar to each other? Okay, let us say PA, P inverse. I have two matrices A and B related by this equation. B is similar to A. For instance, if I write down the matrix of a linear transformation relative to two bases, let us say the matrix A with respect to one basis, matrix B with respect to some other basis, then A and B are related by this equation. Okay. Suppose that B equals PA, P inverse, then can you do, you remember that determinant of B is equal to determinant of A? Determinant of B is determinant of P into determinant of A into determinant of P inverse, that is determinant is multiplicative. Determinant AB is determinant A into determinant B. Now these are numbers. This is determinant P into determinant P inverse into determinant A. But determinant P, determinant P inverse, that is 1. So this is determinant of A. Okay, so similar matrices have the same determinant. This property we will need. Where do we need? We need in the following. Look at B minus lambda I. I have B equal to PA, P inverse. Look at B minus lambda I. B minus lambda I, okay, let me write like this. This is also equal to, instead of B, I have PA, P inverse minus lambda I. I can write this as P A P inverse minus lambda P P inverse. Identity I have written it like this. Now I take P to the left, P inverse to the right, and write this as P into A minus lambda I P inverse. So B minus lambda I is P times A minus lambda I times P inverse. Again use the same formula, apply determinants on both sides. Determinant of B minus lambda I is determinant of A minus lambda I. That is, if B is similar to A, then determinant of B minus lambda I is determinant of A minus lambda I. So is it clear from this that A and B have the same eigenvalues? Similar matrices have the same eigenvalues. Similar matrices have the same eigenvalues. One of the advantages of this result is that the following function is well defined. Calling it determinant of T, I am defining the determinant of a linear transformation. I define a function from the set of all linear transformations to the underlying field. This function I am calling as a determinant function. Determinant of T is a matrix of T relative to B. B is any fixed basis. B is any fixed basis. Is this well defined? In other words, if I change the basis, I meant the determinant of this matrix. Okay. Is this well defined? Determinant of the matrix of T relative to some basis, relative to some fixed basis. Is this well defined? If I change the basis, will I get a different value for that determinant? I will not, because when I change the basis, then the matrices are related by a similarity transformation, but we just now saw that similar matrices have the same determinant. Okay, so this is well defined. This allows us to go from determinant of a matrix to determinant of a linear transformation. Okay, but let's get back to matrices. That's what we want when we want to look at example. So let's look at the eigenvalues and eigenvectors of matrices. I'm really looking at second example. Suppose I have A defined as follows. Let's look at this matrix. Let's calculate the eigenvalues, possibly the eigenvectors. Remember the first example of a linear transformation for which we try to compute the eigenvalues. In the first example, we have seen that it has no eigenvalue, that the deficiency coming from the field. What happens in this example? I need to calculate the eigenvalues, eigenvectors. I must look at the polynomial equation, determinant of A minus lambda I equal to 0. Okay, so let's do this quickly. This is A minus lambda I. Along the main diagonal, I must delete lambda and then calculate the determinant. So I want the determinant of this matrix. 3 minus lambda, 1 minus 1, 2, 2 minus lambda, minus 1, 2, 2 minus lambda. Let's expand it along the first column. Okay, first row, 3 minus lambda into lambda square minus 2 lambda plus 2 minus minus 2 lambda plus 2, 2 minus 2 lambda. Please check the calculations. Minus just 2 lambda. This and this get cancelled. Goes with a minus 2. Please check that the rest of the simplification follows lambda minus 1 into lambda 2 whole square. Okay, please verify this expression simplifies to this. Lambda minus 1 into lambda minus 2 whole square. This is the characteristic polynomial of A, this matrix. So we have no problem with regard to eigenvalues. Lambda equal to 1 is an eigenvalue with multiplicity 1. Lambda equal to 2 is an eigenvalue with multiplicity 2. Okay. So apparently no problem with regard to eigenvalues are concerned. What about eigenvectors? So let us take the case lambda 1 equals 1. We must solve this equation. That is A minus 1 identity, x is 0. So I must solve 2, 1 minus 1, 2, 1 minus 1, 2, 2 minus 1. I am seeking non-zero x that satisfy this equation. I need to do elementary row operations, etc. Okay, but I can observe quickly that this row can be deleted. I can push it to the last row, then that will become the zero row. And then from the first equation and the third equation, what follows is that the second coordinate is 0. We don't have to do elementary row operations. The second row can be removed. It's the same as the first row. That in effect gives a 0 row at the bottom. I have only 2 rows. First row is 2, 1, minus 1. Second row 2, 2, minus 1. It's a homogeneous equation. 2x1 plus x2 minus x3. 2x1 plus 2x2 minus x3. Cancel one from the other. I get x2 to be 0. So x2 is 0. The other equation, single equation, is 2x1 minus x3 equals 0. Any vector x that satisfies these two conditions is an eigenvector corresponding to the eigenvalue 1. There are infinitely many, I agree, but there is precisely one linearly independent vector. I will call it x1. Let us say first coordinate is 1, third coordinate will be 2, second coordinate I know is 0. There is precisely one independent vector that satisfies these two equations. Any other vector is a multiple of this. It is a homogeneous equation. Any other solution is a multiple of this. That is because this is two, see, this is actually two equations in three unknowns. We must fix two. One of them is already fixed. Either x3 or x1 I must fix. For convenience, I fix x3. Then I can determine x1 in terms of x3. Three equations in two unknowns, two must be fixed. X2 is fixed to be 0. Fix x3. So there is only one solution. The dimension of the solution space is 1. So there is only one independent solution for this. So this is an eigenvector corresponding to the eigenvalue 1. Any other vector that satisfies Ax equals lambda x will be a multiple of this, because it is a homogeneous equation. Any multiple is also a solution. So this is one eigenvector. What about the eigenvalue 2? I need to solve A minus 2 times I. X is 0 with X not 0. So I must delete 2. 1, 1, minus 1. I must delete 2. This into X is 0. This into X is 0. I observe that this is a multiple of the first equation. So this gives me 0 row. Now I have two equations in three unknowns. I must fix only one of them. The other two can be determined in terms of this. Is it okay? You can do elementary row operation, but it's obvious. The rank is 2. The rank is 2. So nullity is 1. So let's say for convenience I fix x3. I fix x3 to be 1. By the way, if you go back to this these equations, I have taken x3 to be 2. Can I take x3 to be 0? If I take x3 to be 0, it follows that x1 is 0. So I will get 0, 0, 0. But I want a non-trivial solution. Okay. So that is the reason why I have taken x3 to be 2. We are looking at non-trivial solutions. I do a similar thing here. See, if I take x3 to be 0, then this is gone. I must look for x1, x2 such that this into x1, x2 is 0. This is an invertible matrix. I will again get 0. So I cannot take x3 to be 0. So one of the non-zero choices, simplest x3 equals 1. Then I need to solve for x1 plus x2 is 1, 2x1 is 1. So I will change it to 2 only for convenience. 2x1 is 2. Is that okay? These two equations. So x1 is 1. I will call this x2, the new vector that we obtained by solving this equation. X1 is 1, x3 is 2. Oh, this one is wrong. Is it okay now? 1, 1, 2. 2 minus 2, 1 plus 1, 2, 2 minus 2. So this is the only linearly independent solution of this equation. Any other solutions are multiple of this. Okay. So this time, even though we have obtained three eigenvalues, without counting multiplicity. If I count multiplicity, there are only two eigenvalues. One comes once, two comes twice. But let's say it has three eigenvalues. I don't have three eigenvectors. I don't have three eigenvectors. This is not the deficiency of the field. This is the deficiency of the operator. This is the deficiency of the operator or deficiency of the matrix that we started with. Okay. Now, even at this point, you can verify that this operator is not diagonalizable because it has only two independent eigenvectors. Okay, you can take this as an exercise. This operator is not diagonalizable because it has only two linearly independent eigenvectors. So let's see the connection. Let's see the connection between eigenvalues, eigenvectors, and diagonalizability. So remember, we said that T is diagonalizable if the matrix of T relative to B is a diagonal matrix. Can you see that from this it follows that T is diagonalizable if and only if there is a basis of V each of whose vectors is an eigenvector for T. T is diagonalizable if and only if there is a basis B of V with the property that each basis vector is an eigenvector. The reason why this is true is that if you write down this, then this goes along with the equation TUI equals alpha II UI. That's the reason why this statement is true. Is this clear? What this means is that if T is diagonalizable, then each of the basis vectors that I started with is an eigenvector. U1, U2, etc., UN are basis vectors, so they are not 0. So they are eigenvectors corresponding to the eigenvalues alpha II. Now, what are alpha II? These are the diagonal entries of this diagonal matrix. Okay. So if T is diagonalizable, then each of the basis vectors that I started with is an eigenvector. Conversely, if I have a basis U1, U2, etc., UN such that each vector there is an eigenvector, then I must have some such equation satisfied. I must have TUI equals some gamma II UI. If I get this, then I write down the matrix of T relative to that basis U1, U2, etc., UN, I must get a diagonal matrix. So these statements are equivalent. Okay. Now go back to the previous example. The previous example, we have only two independent eigenvectors. So T is not diagonalizable. The matrix A is not diagonalizable. In the language of the transformation, the linear transformation T induced by A is not diagonalizable. Is this clear? Non-diagonalizability can come from two factors, one from the underlying field, the other one the inherent nature of the transformation T. Okay. In the second example, the problem is with the transformation T. Okay. In the next lectures, let's look at necessary sufficient conditions for diagonalizability. Apart from this, necessary sufficient conditions for diagonalizability, and then properties examples. Okay, let me stop here.